Morning, church. I love that. That was great. It is good to be here today because you are here and God is here, and we're just going to have a good time this morning. We are here to praise God, to come into His presence, to be His people, to learn what Jesus asks of us, and just really to revel and all of the blessings God's given us. So anyway, let's have a word of prayer, and then we're going to get into our worship service. Oh, Lord God, thank you for this wonderful day. It may be cold and a little bit cloudy outside, but this is the day that you have made. And we can't do any better than to simply rejoice and be glad. Lord, we thank you for waking us up, for being with us this morning, for allowing us to be in your presence. Lord, open our hearts that we might receive your word. Open our minds that we might embrace your spirit and bless us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So again, welcome all of you here with us today, and those of you who are with us online, it is exciting to be here, and I'm so glad that you're with us. We've got a few announcements, and somebody has stolen my bulletin. I'm going to borrow. Have you got a bulletin there? Oh boy, who's got a bulletin? Thanks, Dave. Now, Dave won't know what we're going to do, but that's okay. This is just my way of saying, hey, you know what? This is just a normal church. We don't do any fancy perfection productions. We're just doing church together. Anyway, as we're doing this, if you've got a bulletin or a card in front of you, would you pull those cards, those registration cards out? If we have a outbreak of the virus or something that's traced back to the church, we want to be able to provide the information that you will need to keep safe. Okay, the warming tree has started to gather a few warm mittens and hats and stuff. That's downstairs in our welcome center. I would love to see that thing overloaded like Charlie Brown's Christmas tree with all of your gifts so that we can help to bless some kid or some family who is in need and keep their ears and their fingers nice and warm. We are continuing to collect cake mixes or other small Jiffy mixes. I think they make some good cornmeal mixes if you like cornmeal muffins or whatever. They've got all sorts of stuff. Bring them on in and add them to the shopping cart also down in our Welcome Center, and we'll make sure that they get to where they need to go. There's a bunch of thanking of you cards out in the parlor just on the other side of this wall. If you would all make sure that you look those over and add a note or your name to those and help somebody in our congregation and community feel like we remember them. That's so critical. There's a few last poinsettias up here. If one of those is yours and you'd like to bring it home, please do that. And quite frankly, I think most of those have been claimed. If you just like a poinsettia, grab one of them, because the next trip they take is out to the dumpster. Let's see, offering envelopes are available in the parlor on the other side right over here. You can pick those up if you want. And then great news from Brad and Rob and Ennis. They are brand new grandparents of Wren Olivia Ludwig. She was born December 31st. Her parents are Michael and Ashley Ennis Ludwig. So anyway, if you think of them, send them a congratulations, and that is exciting news. I think those are all the announcements I have. Are there some that you would like to add? By the way, I would add, I don't know if it's a joy or an announcement. I think it's actually both, but this last week we decided to add one member to our staff, Becky. She has been our song leader for the duration of this pandemic. She's the voice that you hear when you're online. Thank goodness, because you don't have to listen to me singing. But she's going to help with continue to help with the song leading, and maybe even to help pick some of the hymns. So if you've got some favorite hymns or stuff that you would really like to hear once in a while, this is going to be your go-to person. She's going to kind of ease into this over the next month or so, but she's going to have a lot of input, and I am excited about that. Among other things, I pick most of the hymns we sing. I try to pick ones I'm familiar with, and I think that you can sing. And she's going to add a depth that I don't have, because she's much better at the singing and the music end of things than I am. So I'm excited. Welcome. Not that you haven't been welcome. Any other announcements? That being the case, we become the church as we welcome one another in Christ's name and with Christ's love. I'd invite you to stand and stay where you're at, but stand and welcome one another at this time. Good morning, tech team. Good morning, Lior and Becky. And as you remain standing, I would invite you to turn to hymn number 61, Come, Thou Almighty King. Oh, And I would invite you all to join me in this call to worship. Teach us, God of all peoples, to see every question of national policy in the light of our faith, that we might check in ourselves and in others every passion that makes for war, all ungenerous judgments, all promptings of self-assurance, all presumptuous claims. Grant us to recognize the needs and aspirations of others and remove our suspicions and misunderstandings, that we might honor all people in Jesus Christ our Lord. God of all the ages, in your sight nations rise and fall and pass through times of peril. Now when our land is troubled, be near to judge and save. May leaders be led by your wisdom. May they search for your will and see it clearly. For we have turned from our ways, reverse our course, and help us to repent. Give us your light and your truth. Let them guide us on the paths of righteousness, on the paths that bless others as well as ourselves. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And let us acknowledge who we are and how much we need Christ as we turn to 340, Come Ye Sinners, Poor and Needy. It is time in our service to invite any young people to come forward. Are there some that would like to come forward this morning? I think I have seen this young lady before. ¶¶ Doing today. All right, do you get to visit your grandpa today? Is he a good grandpa? Oh, good. I am so glad to hear that. Otherwise, I'd be very disappointed. He's a good guy, though. Well, you know, sometimes we do the story box for Children's Minute. I don't know if anybody's put anything in there. Do you think there's anything in there? You do? Huh. I wonder how it got there. Well, should I look and see? You what? You think it's a cup of water? Oh, boy. Well, you know what I'm going to have to do? I'm going to have to look at it. Is anything going to bite me? Okay. I have to ask that because, you know, somebody put a turtle in one time. Not here, but in another church. Yeah, oh, my goodness, that was weird. But it is a cup of water. Happily, it's sealed up. Because otherwise, if I did that, she would be very unhappy. Let's see, what if I open it up like that door? Well, what do you think I can say about cup of water? Well, you know, Jesus had something to say about a cup of water. In one of his very, very famous stories, he talked about one time that if we feed somebody or give them clothes or even give them a cup of water, that it's just exactly the same as if we gave him that cup of water. Because, you know, when we take care of God's people, Jesus said, it's just like you're taking care of me. So sometimes one of the best ways we can take care of people and how we can show our love for Jesus is by helping somebody else. Maybe we give them a cup of water if they're thirsty. Maybe we feed them when we're hungry. You know, we were talking a little bit ago, we put all sorts of food in that basket downstairs. Anything that we do to take care of somebody else, it's just like we're taking care of Jesus. It's that important to him. So I'm going to give you this water back. Maybe you will see somebody that looks thirsty, and you can give it to them, saying, you know what? I care about you, and so does Jesus. What do you think about that? It does sound good, doesn't it? I'm going to give that right back to you. I'm so glad you put that in there. You're very clever. Let's pray together, okay? Lord God, I ask your blessings on this beautiful girl. Help her to grow up to be a strong woman of faith. Help her to show her love for everyone in this world. Because when she does, she's showing them the love of Jesus. Bless her and all of her family. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you so much. Would you like to go back to your grandpa now? All right. And as she's going back, it is time for us to share our joys and our concerns. And I wonder, what are you joyful about today? All right, Leora's got a joy.
Yes, my daughter-in-law, Rhonda, and thank you for preparing for them to get out of the hospital and come home.
Okay. Leora's daughter-in-law, Rhonda, has been able to come home from the hospital and is doing much better. Thank you. Other joys? I've got a big one. A certain member of our congregation, and I'm not going to mention Heather by name, even though she's up in the tech center. She's going to turn 17 on, I think, Thursday, right? Happy birthday. You know, we ought to sing happy birthday. Give us a note, Becky. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Heather. Happy birthday to you.
And by the way, folks, beware. She gets her senior driver's license. Oh, boy. Anyway, happy birthday, Heather. What other joys do you have? Wow, no, nobody's got a joy? Oh, my goodness. Yes, Sandy. Okay, Sandy's brother is doing much better. He had COVID, and he's, I guess, recovering now. Hallelujah. Others? You know, we have reached the point now where I think everybody knows somebody who either has COVID or has passed away from COVID. And whatever conspiracy theories there may be out there, it's true. It's here. It's real. And we pray for all of those whose lives are affected. The fact that you all are here this morning wearing masks and separating from one another is proof that it's here. Keep up your vigilance. The vaccine is coming, but it's going to be a while. So anyway, that's my spiel on that. Are there any concerns? Not seeing any? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord God, we give you thanks for this church, for our families, those brought together by bloodlines and marriage, those whom we have joined together with in Holy Communion, and all of our friends who we feel connected with. Lord, we thank you for all these persons in our lives, for they are part of who we are. Lord, bless them. Give them health. Help those who are struggling with infirmities of the mind, the body, or the spirit. Lead us to wholeness. We thank you for the efforts of all of those in the various medical professions, which have brought us to a point where we can combat against this thing. We thank you also for the same persons who are working on so many other diseases and infirmities, and pray your blessings upon them so they can continue finding cures for our diseases, for our wounds, our broken bones, and everything else. Lord, I pray for peace this week. We are in such a tumultuous time, perhaps the most tumultuous that any of us can remember. Lord, just pour your peace out upon this nation. Help us to look with tolerance, and even more than that, with love, upon one another, whether we agree with one another or disagree. Help us, Lord, not to be the spreaders of intolerance and hatred, but instead let us be the ones to either keep quiet or, when we must, to speak words with love. I pray, Lord, against all forms of violence which may take place. That is nothing you have taught anywhere in the Bible. You have always taught peace and taught love. And we give you thanks for that. And ask you, Lord, pour your Spirit into us that we might be your ambassadors into this world. Let your peace start with us. Lord, we ask your blessings on our nation's leaders, those departing, those coming in. Bless them all, especially for the new ones coming in, Lord. Speak wisdom to them. Cause them to seek your face as we do here. Cause them to use your wisdom to govern wisely. And let them set aside all personal agendas, party agendas, motives, whatever else, and help them to seek to be truly public servants. And for us, Lord, fill us with your Spirit. Help us to be prepared to go out into the world beyond here and to speak the gospel, to share it in actions, thoughts, and words. Help us, O Lord, to bring your kingdom to come. Lord, we pray all of these things as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite Rena to come forward and share God's word with us in Scripture.
Would you please rise as you are able for the New Testament reading? Our first reading comes to us from Romans 1, verse 16. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God that brings salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew, then to the Gentile. The second reading comes to us from Mark 9, verses 36 and 37. Then he put a little child among us. Taking the child in his arm, he said to them, Anyone who welcomes a little child like this on my behalf welcomes me. And anyone who welcomes me welcomes not only me, but also my Father who sent me. This has been the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
You may be seated. And Becky is going to share God's word with us in a song which fits in perfectly with our theme for worship this month, disciple making.
Wealthy nor wise one,
That is one of my favorite hymns. It's the story of Peter, the fisherman, who Jesus came up to one day, probably while he was mending his nets. Jesus came up to a common, ordinary fisherman, probably still smelling like fish, soiled and dirty and tired. And he looked upon him. And he saw in Peter a greater potential than Peter ever had seen in himself. And you remember the words that he said to Peter, "Right now you are a fisherman. I will make you a fisher of men." And of course, Peter, being the disciple that I really identify so well with, he was kind of like the bumbling kind of fool. It seemed like he kind of got it, but then he'd go off on a wild tangent by himself, and Peter or Jesus would have to take and rein him back in again and set him straight. I identify so well with this man. But he was also the one, the first one to truly understand that having walked with Jesus as one of his disciples, the day that Jesus asked the disciples, "Who do you say I am?" Peter, inspired by God, answered, You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." He got it. He became one of the great fathers of the church. A simple fisherman, an ordinary person, whom Jesus looked into his eyes and saw something that Peter had no idea was there. And I wonder, does Jesus look into our eyes? And what does he see there which we have not seen for ourselves? What's in it? Today we are in a sermon series that is examining one of the core principles of why we gather as church, and even more than that, why we have gathered together as a Methodist church, and what it is that defines us, that defines our mission. And of course, we take our mission statement directly from the Great Commission that Jesus gave us, where he said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the end of the age." That, friends, is Jesus' mission statement for every single one of us. So not surprisingly, the United Methodist Church has decided that that really ought to be where we start. The mission of the United Methodist Church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. The big statement. Make disciples, followers, believers of Jesus Christ, that the world might be transformed. You know, if we were to go out and teach the world what we have learned, what we take to be part of who we are, the world will be transformed. We can ask ourselves, well, I'm too old, or I'm in a little community called Paola, or in a little church in a little community of Paola, what difference can I make? But every time we go out and share the gospel, every time we go out and teach how to get along with one another and how to get along with God, Every time we go out and preach against violence and preach for peace, we have improved a little bit of the world. And if enough of us do that, just like those lights that we light up on Christmas Eve, where one little light comes in and it's a tiny little glow, but soon every one of us has a light we're holding on to, and the place becomes warm and lit. That's how we change the world for Jesus Christ, into the world that God had always hoped for, into the world that becomes a mirror of His kingdom in heaven. For when we get to God's kingdom in heaven, do we expect a place where there's going to be bitterness and strife and violence? Or don't we all expect to be in a place where love is the chief attribute that each person has for one another? Where peace is just that, it's peace. There's no more strife. And so we are inviting people in to a better way of life, a way of life that makes sense, a way of life by which we can get along with other people, even if we disagree with them. That's the thing that just disturbs me so much. It's okay to disagree with somebody. That doesn't mean we have to go out and hate them. We can disagree with somebody. That doesn't make them a bad person. And quite frankly, it doesn't make us a bad person either. Each of us has different ideas, different thoughts, different opinions, but we are called to love one another. And when we cover everything over with that love for one another, we change the world. So part of what I'm doing this month, and possibly a little bit in the next month, is bringing out some of the ways specific to who we are that we go about making disciples. Because it's one thing to say, okay, everybody, been great, good to see you in church, now go make disciples. Preacher, how do I do that? Good question. So glad you asked. I'll read another thing from the Book of Discipline. Book of Discipline, by the way, has some wonderful, powerful pieces in it. It's not just the rules on who can serve on what committee. It's got some very powerful statements of how we carry out our mission, how we do ministry together. One of those statements that says, and again, it's a little repetitious right here, but it says the mission of the church is to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world by proclaiming the good news of God's grace, by exemplifying Jesus' command to love God and neighbor, thus seeking the fulfillment of God's reign and realm in the world. That was good. So we see that this is actually an extension of what Jesus already started. He came bringing with him the kingdom of heaven. We are to continue developing that kingdom, God's reign here in this world, so that when we pray the Lord's Prayer together and we are saying, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," we want all of the characteristics that we expect in heaven to actually begin and to take shape and to take place here in this world. You know, I was talking about a leadership class one time, a long time ago, and one of the things we focused on is, where do you see yourself in 5 years or 10 years from now? What do you see yourself doing? What will you be like? What do you want to be like? And of course, there's all sorts of people had all sorts of great ideas. And then the professor asked, okay, well, what are you doing right now to get there? You know? How do you start a journey? First step. You can't... I wish I was like Jesus where, you know, he could suddenly go from one side of the lake to another. You can find that in the gospel. We've got to take the first step. If you see yourself in a particular place or in a particular way, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, you got to start today to get there. You know, my own journey in a ministry was very much like that. I had to be willing to take some steps that I thought, that's not me, God. No, I don't want to do that. Are you kidding me, God? But you know what? I felt God urging me. And I took those steps. I recall even earlier on, back when I had been working in a greenhouse as a grower, working with tropical plants and cactuses and stuff like that. And I came to realize it was a small family-owned business and I wasn't going to go anywhere. So I thought, well, I've got a hobby. It's woodworking. Maybe I'll go work for a construction company, a remodeling company. Well, okay, big step there. So I went and applied, found a job, hired on as a laborer. I got to tell you, that first day on the job, I had exactly one thing in mind. Maybe it was a little bit arrogant, maybe it wasn't, but that first day, I thought, I want to be the top carpenter in this company. And so every minute I had to spare, every opportunity I had to talk to someone, whether it was an electrician or a plumber or to read a book or whatever else, I would go into the old B. Dalton's bookstores. Anybody remember those? The B. Dalton's bookstores in the mall? My wife would go into the Jones store and go into all those weird little makeups and perfumes and all that sort of stuff that us guys hate. I mean, we like it when our wives and our girlfriends or whatever put them on, but I don't want to even be close. So I'd go in there and I would go through the magazines, I'd go through the books, and I would read and read and read, and every minute was aiming for that moment when I could rise and become a little bit better and a little bit better, until one day I actually achieved that dream. Perhaps it was because it wasn't the top remodeling company in Kansas City, but it was a good remodeling company. I went from there shortly afterwards to one of the top remodeling companies in Kansas City. And I earned a position, first as a carpenter, then as a foreman. And I won't try to make the claim that I was the best of the best that ever was. I was pretty good, though. Part of it had to do with starting off, taking that first step with a goal in mind. And friends, that's exactly what we do in this kingdom of God. Is Jesus came. He spoke to 12 disciples who took and carried the message to others, who shared the love of God for others, so that the kingdom of God might grow. And it wasn't that Jesus wanted to be the top dog and have the most people in his church. It's he realized he was the church, and that in him is forgiveness and redemption, and that he would be the perfect example of God's love to the extent that he was willing to die for our sake, holding nothing back. And then he called those who had been following him to go and do likewise, not necessarily to die, although I will say that I think all except the gospel writer John died some pretty miserable deaths, but they died with joy in their hearts, knowing that they had a place in the kingdom of God, knowing that they had done their part to advance the kingdom of God. So this morning I want to turn, let's see if I can find it here, into the book of Acts, because we don't do this alone. We don't just go out. Peter didn't just go out and preach and teach the whole world to come to God. He and the other disciples and the apostle Paul, and then through them and past them, countless others went out with the same thing. Out of the gospel, or out of the book of Acts, it says, "You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Other gospel writers say it differently, but same message. Out of Mark, it says, Jesus said to them, "Go into all the world and preach the gospel to all creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whoever does not will be condemned." And then John tells it, as usual, in a very different way. On the very end of the Gospel of John, has got this situation with Peter. Peter had turned his back on Jesus and denied him when he was put on trial. But Jesus was willing to restore even that. So it said, after they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" "Yes, Lord," he said. "You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my lambs." Again, Jesus said, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Again, Peter answered, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said, "Take care of my sheep." And then a third time he said to him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" And Peter was hurt, because Jesus asked him the third time, "Do you love me?" He said, "Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." Jesus, in each of these gospel readings and in the book of Acts, is telling his disciples what he expected of them, that they would go out into the world and proclaim that there was good news, would proclaim God's love for them, would issue God's invitation to go out and teach others, to go out and be invited into the kingdom of God. This is not an exclusive club. This is something which we are all called to go out and do. In the book of discipline, it says we make disciples as we proclaim the gospel, seek, welcome, and gather persons into the body of Christ. It says in the midst of a sinful world, through the grace of God, we are brought to repentance and faith in Jesus Christ. We become aware of the presence and life-giving power of God's Holy Spirit. We live in confident expectation of the ultimate fulfillment of God's purpose. With that expectation, with that confidence, Jesus bids us go. Go and make disciples. So we are to proclaim the gospel. Does that mean that each of you is supposed to get up on a soapbox or stand on a corner or up in a pulpit and preach the word? No. Rather, some of your most powerful testimony is when you go out and proclaim the gospel, doing the word. Sometimes being willing, if there's an opening in a conversation, to talk about your own faith. You know, each of you, I'm sure, is aware or has had experiences with those who have come up to you and says, "You must repent right now and proclaim Jesus Christ the Savior, or you're going down." Friends, that's never really won anybody, has it? But you know, when we show the love of Christ to others, when we give that cup of water to a stranger because they're thirsty, or give them something to eat, or give them something to wear, or care for them in any way, that's an act of proclaiming the gospel. And if in conversation we have the opportunity, we can share with them our story. It doesn't have to be their story. It doesn't have to be the story. But a story perhaps of why you are being kind, or who it is that's behind your kindness. Little steps. Little steps. You know, Peter didn't start off a powerful evangelist. He bumbled along for quite a while until on the day of Pentecost, receiving the gift of the Holy Spirit within him, he stood up on that day and preached a sermon that reached 3,000 people. I've got to tell you, as a pastor, I've always wanted to preach that sermon and cause 3,000 people to fall in love with God, to receive the gift of God. But each of us is to go out and proclaim the gospel in some way. We're to seek and welcome. That means we have to open our eyes and become aware of the people around us, to maybe deliberately look for the one that looks lost, for the least and the lost, and to be willing to engage them in some way, hopefully a safe way, but to be willing to engage them. We are to seek. You know, it's not enough that we gather here in church together. I mean, it's a wonderful thing, a powerful thing, a needful thing, but we are to seek those who have not connected with Christ and do something to show them the love of Christ. And something that is very dear to my heart that you are so good at, welcome. You know, when somebody comes into our midst, and I've asked several new members over the course of time I've been here, well, why do you want to join this church? Because we have felt so welcome here. I'll tell you what, more powerful words could not have been spoken. And those are those moments when I am so filled up with pride for you all. Because you're good at that. Stranger comes into our midst, they're welcome here. Whatever they look like, whatever they sound like, maybe even someday whatever they smell like. But you know what? I am so proud of the way you all welcome. These things are so important. I personally believe that the gospel of Jesus Christ is as important or more important today in these tumultuous, torn, confusing times where it seems everybody's going off and different directions, there's violence, there's distrust, there's hatred. What a better way than to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, that all are loved by God, that there is invitation, that there is welcome, that there is hope. There's a better way to live. One of my seminary professors once talked about the downfall of the Roman Empire, where the Pax Romana, the peace of Rome, which was a peace instilled by violence, was replaced by the Pax of Jesus, the peace and the love of Jesus. Jesus came into a world filled with thousands of false gods and idols and showed a much more meaningful, comprehensive theology of one God. A God that didn't need to have human sacrifice or all these ritual sacrifices, but rather wanted a broken and contrite heart, wanting us to love one another. And he dared to offer hope. Hope into a world that was sorely oppressed. These were the people that Jesus came among, those who were being horribly oppressed. He gave them hope that there could be a better way of living, other than what they were living as virtual slaves in the Roman Empire. And eventually, according to this professor, the Roman Empire crumbled under these two things. It couldn't hold up. So we can go out and share with them the love of Christ. We have to go where we are needed the most. We have to go and seek those who need it the most. The Sunday school class this morning was doing a study on the city of Sardis. And the video was talking about, well, one of the passages in Revelation regarding Sardis. It says, "To the angel of the church in Sardis write, these are the words of him who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars. I know your deeds. You have a reputation of being alive, but you are dead. Wake up! Strengthen what remains and is about to die, for I have found your deeds unfinished in the sight of my God. Remember, therefore, what you have received and heard. Hold it fast and repent. But if you do not wake up, I will come like a thief, and you will not know at what time I will come to you. Yet you have a few people in Sardis who have not soiled their clothes. They will walk with me dressed in white, for they are worthy. The one who is victorious will, like them, be dressed in white. I will never blot out the name of that person from the book of life, but will acknowledge that name before my Father and his angels. Whoever has ears, let them hear." I am not claiming that about this church, but there is a warning that we must be doing so much more than just simply coming together on Saturday or Sundays, that we must be going out into the world to proclaim, to seek, and to welcome those to whom Christ is a stranger, and sharing with them this incredible hope that we almost take for granted, this incredible love that God has. I look at some of the violence on TV, the news coverage, I say, wow, how I wish they knew how much God loves them. Because if they did, they might change forever. Let us resolve to proclaim the gospel in word, in acts, and everything else we do, that we might share it with the rest of the world. Amen? Let's pray. Lord God, you have given us a big task. It's not necessary that everybody go out and preach a sermon, but rather to let them share you, Jesus Christ, in the things that they do, in their interactions with one another. Let us all keep in mind the love that God has for us, and let us respond by offering that love to everyone else. And pray that they too, having experienced our love for them, desire to know that love that God has. Bless us in this. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. As we continue to worship, we give back to God in gratitude for all that God has done for us, especially through Jesus Christ. And we give in order to continue our ministry in all of the world. And so this morning we are accepting your gifts, your tithes, and your offerings virtually or physically. We've got the offering plates around here. You who are worshiping with us online, are given plenty of information on our closing slides on how to do that. And friends, you have been so faithful. This church is still strong financially because of you, and we thank you. So at this time, I receive your offerings and bid you stand as we sing praises to God. Bring you these gifts in many forms, and we pray that you will bless those, bless them, and the ones who gave them. Use these gifts, O Lord, for the church the world over. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. And as you remain standing, and I invite you to turn to our closing hymn, we'll sing one verse. Be seated for a minute. Next week, we are going to be continuing in the series. If we can have that slide up, Joel. We make disciples as we lead people to commitment. And we'll be looking at another way that we continue the process of making disciples for the transformation of the world. And now, friends, it comes to a moment I have dreaded for a long time. For the past year, I've been struggling with a decision, and I will be retiring as of July 1st. I'm 67 years old. My wife is retired. She would like me to spend some time with her, do some traveling, and just enjoy some life. Been a terrible, hard decision for me because I have loved being the pastor of this church more than you'll ever know. You all have given me that welcome, made me part of your lives, and I feel alive here. But the decision has been made. The bishop has granted the request. Not that he had much choice. This time I listened to my wife. But I'm sorry for that on one hand, but I'm looking forward to a new position in life. And hopefully I won't be a complete stranger to you past that point. We'll see how that goes. I will say that in the days to come, I'm expecting that our PPR committee, our pastor-parish relations committee, we'll be issuing and figuring out some ways to talk with you all about some of the things you might like in a new pastor. And, that's really all I've got to say for that. I've just loved being here. I've got some more months to go, so I'm not out the door yet. We've got a chance for a little bit more barbecue somewhere here. So, anyway, you have blessed me. You have blessed me. Wait, go out into the world. Make disciples of Jesus Christ and know that by doing so, you are transforming the world. Be blessed. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thought.